All right, here he comes.
I'm here at the Phoenix Raceway for the NASCAR Championship Series, but I'm here for a very special reason. The race is gonna be amazing all by itself, but ABB has invited us to check out their prototype EV. Let's see if we can get to the bottom of how awesome this car is, some of the specs, and what this is all about. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Adventure.
This video is brought to you by ERANGE EV.
Here it is behind me. Let's talk a little bit about this car. This car was made in conjunction with Ford, Toyota, and GM, all three members that make cars for NASCAR. Now, it also follows part of what NASCAR is talking about for their next generation. This isn't a clean sheet design. The structure is actually a flaxseed composite, which is interesting. It's biodegradable, and while it's heavier and not as mechanically stiff and strong as carbon fiber, it is more impact absorbing, so it has some properties there. Now on the inside is where things get interesting. You can just see the roll cage. Safety is paramount here. There's an entire roll structure all the way around, both for the driver and for this battery pack. Now here is where the battery lives, right here. 78 kilowatt hour NMC battery pack, which is not even as big as my Tesla Model S, for example. But it's housed to the right of the driver. Now to offset that weight, obviously you have the driver on one side, but also the front motor is actually biased as well toward the driver to help offset the weight. So the motor is over here, transmission, and then it goes out to the wheels. Also, the electric battery pack system has a dielectric coolant. It's a dielectric oil, as opposed to the water glycol, which cools the inverters and the motors. And that's because the dielectric oil is non-conductive. So if some of it were to leak, it would not cause any kind of shorts in the battery pack. So safety obviously is paramount. Let's also talk about this. The number on the side of this car is very significant as well. As you can see, it's a number 35, which doesn't have a huge winning pedigree in terms of racing, but the 35 denotes NASCAR's goal to be carbon neutral in their operations by 2035. That's where it comes from, Impact 2035. That means that while NASCAR races might still be gasoline powered, they're trying to make their operations, the logistics, all of the pit crews and everything else carbon neutral by 2035. So like I mentioned, there's three electric motors, one in front and two in the back. Each is good for about 333 kilowatts of power for a total system of 1,000 kilowatts. And that's even more power than this screaming V8 you hear behind me. This has more power than any NASCAR would. It's about 1,300 horsepower. Now, that's so much torque, and again, with electric motors having instant torque, it produces so much power that Goodyear had to make a special racing slick just for this car to be able to cope with that much power. For that same reason, this is the very first NASCAR that has all-wheel drive because it has the two motors. Typically, you have engine in front, drive axle, and rear-wheel drive. Another first for NASCAR would be this, the wing. Normally NASCARs don't have this, and obviously this isn't a spec racing car, but this has the wing. Also very interesting, most NASCARs follow like the Camaro or the Camry, some kind of a coupe silhouette, but this is actually a crossover SUV silhouette, just part of the packaging and what they're trying to do. So this is gonna have more power than any traditional NASCAR would.
I make it a point to bring the amazing engineering stories happening all around us to you each and every week. For example, tires, which have come a long way. And our sponsor, ERANGE EV, makes some of the most amazing tires for your EV. Here's why. ERANGE EV's EcoPoint 3 technology means that all the rubber, filler, and compounding agents are mixed uniformly under continuous liquid phase conditions, resulting in a more consistent compound. The result? The very rare in engineering win-win-win, with better performance and grip, a quieter ride, better range thanks to lower rolling resistance, and longer life. ERANGE EV tires also feature a higher load-bearing capacity for that extra weight with your EV's batteries and incredible grip for that instant torque that EVs are known for. We even tested some of these claims by driving a total of 30 miles, 15 there and 15 back, and we found a 2 decibel drop in sound from an average of 68 on the stock tires to 66 decibels with the ERANGE EV tires. And for range, we've noticed a 5% drop, good for over 15 miles of range on a full charge. So yes, EVs are heavier, but the tires don't have to be a problem. With ERANGE EV tires, you can have a 50,000 mile warranty, quieter tires, better range, and better performance and grip. Check out the ERANGE EV line of tires, links in description. for your next set of tires for your EV. Huge thanks to ERANGE EV and you. Now back to the show.
I don't know if you can hear that, but it's not quiet. Obviously, it's not a V8. You're not gonna get the fury of one of these traditional gasoline NASCAR cars, but it does have this amazing high-tech, high pitch, kind of like a Formula One sound. It's what electric motors do at 16,000 RPM. Ultimately, it'll be the battery size. He's already made a pit stop, changed out wheels, and that battery pack is probably good for 1 mile circuit, I don't know, maybe 50 laps or so before he'd have to recharge. Now, this particular prototype isn't made for fast recharging. This is more of a demonstrator to show just what an electric NASCAR would look like. Yeah, tell me about it, just like generally as a driver, what's the difference in terms of like just visceral feel and what's your takeaway from it?
The biggest thing that I had to get used to as a driver is just not having that noise and that distraction that was really overpowering, and you don't realize how loud it was in the race car until you don't have it at all. And then you start noticing so many things that you really never noticed before. The tires make a distinct noise in the corner. All the rubber and the debris kind of banging off underneath the car. And so it does allow you to maybe focus a little bit more.
Yeah.
But ultimately, it's still about how fast you can get out of the corners, how aggressive you can be getting into the corners. But what makes this car unique is the adjustability. When you have the adjustability for power distribution, for wheel spin, for the brake regeneration that allows you to get into the corner so much harder, it really pushes the limits to the car. And we've just seen the early stages of that.
So one of the things I was talking to the engineers a little before I came out here is it's about 350 kilowatts per motor, three of them, about 1,000 total, 1,300 horsepower, but a single speed gearbox. So
that's right.
16,000 RPM range for an electric motor. But you still have decisions to make as far as you want that low-end mechanical advantage or high-end top speed.
Yeah.
How is this car currently dialed in?
So what makes this sport so unique is NASCAR goes to short tracks, intermediates, big tracks, and road courses. And to your point, the adjustability that this car has, if you're at a road course, it's all about accelerating out of those corners and maximizing your braking zone, getting into the corners. And so you would have a little different philosophy on power management, regen, and even setup. But here, it's kind of that intermediate. You want the pure power, that top end speed to carry down the straightaway because you never really slow down a dramatic amount in the corner. But when we go to a bigger track one day that you can't even see turn three from here, it's all about top speed because you don't even touch the brakes at some of those bigger tracks.
I heard the closest comp for you was the F-16 fighter jet.
Yeah.
Is that whole true?
It's still close. You know, I threw up in the F-16. I haven't thrown up in this thing. I don't want to do that yet. But no, it's been a lot of fun.
Now, one thing that David Ragan mentioned is that he loves how customizable this car is. What he means by that is this has electric motors, which are good for about 0 to 16,000 RPM. That's a much wider operational range than a gas car. But I guess even better, because electric motors produce nearly peak output instantaneously and hold it pretty much throughout that entire range. A gas car might redline at 8,000 RPM, but it will make very little torque until 3,500, 4,000, and then hold it for a little while and then fall off very quickly. It has a very small band. But based on which track you're on, you could configure this car differently. So if you have long straightaways and high speeds, you have to make that a little bit taller so you can go to higher speeds. If you've got shorter ovals like this, you can gear it down for more mechanical advantage, more torque off the line, and a lower top speed. But that's all adjustable with just a single gear ratio pack in the transmission. Also, the regenerative braking levels and how it's dialed to the pedal is wildly changeable as well. Again, here, just an oval, you're not really braking very much. You're just kind of holding a pretty much a fixed speed. So the regen braking is probably throttled down and have, you know, less modulation on the brake pedal. But if you're on a road track where you have long straights where you're going 220 miles an hour and then you have to slam on your brake to slow down, the regen can be as high as 500 kilowatts, which is basically limited by how much energy the batteries can take back in. So Riley, we're here talking about electric NASCARs, which is cool, but there's a entire mechanism of logistics that goes into each and every one of these races.
Yeah.
Tell us more about this initiative to be carbon neutral?
Yeah, so we have a company goal of net zero operating emissions by 2035, so not full carbon neutrality yet. But really what that means is we are in our third year of measuring our carbon footprint annually, and that first measurement in 2022 informed us that a lot of our footprint is really based on energy and is focused around energy. So when you think about the light bulbs at track, the tractor trailers that we're bringing across the country each weekend, that's really the bulk of our emissions. And yes, race fuel is part of it, but that's just a small part of what this larger ecosystem does every single weekend. And so that 2035 goal is focused around our scope one and our scope two, which is the fuel that we burned at our own facilities. So NASCAR is a family-owned business. The France family also owns 15 racetracks, like Phoenix here. And so it's the emissions from these facilities that we're focused on from that scope one. And so it's everything from building emissions, what you use to cook and heat and cool our buildings and our facilities, our mobile assets. So each track has a series of track vehicles, pace cars, forklifts, tractor trailers, and different pieces of mobile equipment. That's part of that scope one, and then the race fuel itself. And then scope two is our electricity. So everything that we're using to turn the lights on every single weekend.
All right, just finished my very first NASCAR race, and what better race than the championship? Congrats to Joey Logano, really awesome. By the end of it, I really knew what I was doing, looking at the right cars, and really got into it. So really, really good fun. Now, I set out to answer a question. How important is the sound and the fury of that V8 NASCAR, and would an electric version be comparable? And I gotta tell you, the sound, it hits you in your chest is pounding, and it is visceral and loud. Although by about lap 20, it was kind of unbearable. Like, I mean, there's no way you wouldn't lose your hearing. So I had earplugs on. Most people either had muffs with the game being broadcast, like the radio signals from the teams being broadcast into their headset, or earplugs. So it's kind of like a loud car. Sounds like a good idea until an hour-long road trip and you go, man, I could really go for some peace and quiet. So as far as the sound goes, I have a feeling NASCAR fans would still love electric NASCAR. But I want to close with this. The point of this effort, what ABB and NASCAR are doing, is not to replace this. This is not going anywhere. If you love old school V8 NASCAR, I think you're going to love it in the future, and it's not going anywhere. And here's why. Each one of those cars consumed about 80 gallons of gasoline. That means the entirety of all the NASCAR races uses under 120,000 gallons of gasoline. And that's about 250 passenger cars. That's it. Those refueling cans hold 12 gallons of gasoline, and one of these NASCARs can hold about 1.5 of those, about 18 to 20 gallons of gasoline. But that one 12-gallon can weighs about 100 pounds and has about 350 kilowatt hours of energy. To have a comparable amount of energy in one of these cars with electric batteries today, it would weigh about 2,400 pounds to do the same. And that's kind of the point, is gasoline is incredible for energy density. And when it comes to racing, this is a great application for it. If you had regular traditional NASCAR and NASCAR E, we're just adding to the types of things we can get behind. And great engineering goes into all of this stuff. Imagine the engineering of a V8 and gasoline and all those decisions about pitting and when and how often you're gonna take stops, how hard you're gonna push it, when you need to change your tires. There's a million things that go into it. With electric NASCAR, it'll be the same thing. What kind of gear ratio do you have? Do you go for top end speed or low end torque and all the rest? It's amazing what happens when you can have some fun. And I think that's the takeaway, folks. NASCAR, pretty damn cool, and the future is gonna be super bright. All right, that is a quick look at NASCAR Championship Weekend. Thank you so much for watching. Tune in, subscribe, like, share this video. Until next week, I'm Ricky with Tuba Da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching. That's a wrap, folks.